Hello all, today we are going to discuss obstetric lecture and the topic is prolonged labor. We had seen abnormalities during labor or abnormal presentations of labor, like occipito posterior, breech, shoulder, transverse lying. In this lecture we are going to discuss about the abnormalities during labor. So in that, first topic is prolonged labor, that you called as excessive labor pain or abnormal uterine action. In both way, this term is called as abnormality of labor, it is prolonged labor or abnormal uterine action. So prolonged labor, it is defined as when first and second stage of labor is more than 24 hours. We know the duration of first and second stage in primary patient as well as in multipara patient. But if the duration is more than 24 hours, first and second stage is extended more than 24 hours, then that labor is called as prolonged labor. This is not the normal duration. So whenever the stages are expected to be more than 18 to 24 hours, then those things are not normal. So we called it as prolonged labor. Now, causes for this prolonged labor, mainly it is because of the fault in passage, that is female pelvis, bony pelvis is the passage. So whenever there are problems or faults in that, those factors are mainly responsible to cause extension in labor. So fault in passage is mainly because of CPD, that is contracted pelvis, cephalopelvic disproportion, maybe due to cervical dystocia, maybe due to any tumor cyst in pelvic cavity, full bladder, any abnormal growth in pelvic cavity. So all these things are said to be fault in passage. Uterine fibroid, uterine tumor, ovarian cyst, ovarian tumor, CPD and cervical stenosis, dystocia, any abnormal growth, bladder related abnormality, enlarged bladder, full bladder. So all these things are taken in fault in passage thing. Next is fault in power. Power means uterine contractions. Those contractions which are not sufficient to cause the labor pain, those contractions we called it as abnormal or insufficient contractions. So it is called as uterine inertia. So abnormal contractions like uterine inertia, cervical dystocia, there is a ring in between upper active segment of uterus and lower passive segment, we call it as physiological ring. But if this ring is very constricted, that ring is called as constriction ring. So development of this constriction ring in between the uterine segments, overuse of analgesic drugs to reduce the pain in early stage, we give some analgesics or sedatives. But if they are given in wrong amount, or if we give overdose of these injections, that can cause the laxity of muscles. So sufficient contractions are not seen. So overuse of analgesic drugs, injection oxytocin, improper use of that, sudden psychological factor in between the labor pain. So all these things are responsible to cause the prolonged labor, especially in the power thing. So fault in power. Next is fault in passenger. Passenger is the baby. So any problem related to that baby that will cause prolonged labor. So important things are malpresentations, occipito posterior presentations of baby, face presentation, brow presentation, ridge presentation, shoulder or transverse presentation. So any abnormal presentation away from the vertex presentation that will cause the prolonged labor. Next is twin pregnancy, hydramniosis, hydrocephalus, anencephalus, baby, any congenitally abnormal baby that may lead to prolonged labor. So these are the causes which can cause the extension during the first and second stage. Fault in passage, fault in power, fault in passenger. So these things we should consider. If at all any of these things are noticed during ANC profile, then we can group the patient as a high risk patient and we can straight away refer that patient for cesarean. So early identification of these factors is important to avoid the maternal as well as fetal complications. Now apart from these causes, there are some other causes, like if patients with any unknown factor, any psychological sudden setback during labor, that can lead to extension of labor. In some cases, there is everything is normal. Maternal factors are normal. There is no fault in power, passage, passenger, nothing is there. But still stages are prolong. So these are idiopathic things. So these are some causes for prolonged labor. Next is effect of this prolonged or extension of stages on so effects or complications of these on mother and fetus. So first of all, we will discuss about the complications related to mother. Whenever the stages of labor are extended, it is more than 18 to 24 hours. At that stage, that female having the severe labor pain, uterine contractions are there. We are doing the PSPV examination, giving various types of injections for dilatation, for contraction and other things. That patient becomes very much exhausted because of over use of these injections as well as the contractions, uterine contractions, labor pains. Patient becomes very much exhausted. She is dehydrated. There may be acidosis because of the repeated examination and prolonged time in the labor room. She may have septicemia. Septic focus can develop. She may go in septic shock because of excessive fever pain, neurogenic shock. So various types of shocks can be developed, and because of overuse of this overuse of the analgesic and other things, there may be necrosis. So many complications related to mother can take place, and because of the various types of shock and infection, she may go in the severe complication complicative stage, and there may be death of patient. It can also lead to heavy bleeding, trauma or injury to genital tract, PPH. Patient can have excessive bleeding, sometimes uterine rupture, and many complications can take place, and that may lead to other things are like perineal tear, cervical tear, lacerations. So each and every complication can take place, and because of the mismanaged stage, there may be retention of placenta even after delivery. There may be retention of placenta, retention of fetal tissues in the uterus. That also leads to PPH, postpartum hemorrhage after delivery. Sometimes it may lead to embolism. Amniotic fluid embolism can set. And because of the over use of drugs as well as by excessive pressure, fundal pressure also during the delivery, we can do inversion of uterus. So all these complications can take place because of this prolonged labor, and ultimately if it is not treated, that may lead to maternal death. Next is fetal complications. Because of the prolonged duration of this labor, there is contraction of uterus for long time, and because of this contraction, fetal distress is a common thing, and because of the distress, patient gets baby gets diminished oxygen supply. That leads to hypoxia. Baby may pass meconium during this phase, and because of the meconium passage, sometimes aspiration, especially pneumonia like complications can also occur. But meconium passage is always dangerous for baby because the baby can aspirate it, and there may be death of baby. So various types of infections can also take place. There may be early rupture of membrane. Without complete dilatation, rupture gets membrane. Membrane gets ruptured, and because of this rupture, amniotic fluid loss, and because of the fluid loss, there may be diminished or less oxygen supply to baby, and that cause that causes fetal hypoxia, fetal death. So there may be sometimes injury to fetal presenting part because of the over use, or we do the PSPV examination repeatedly. We use some instruments for the examination, and that may lead to various types of injuries to baby. So these complications can occur to the mother and baby. Now, types of this prolonged labor. First type is uterine inertia or hypotonic uterus. This is a type, or you can call it as groups of this prolonged labor. Patients are divided in these types of group. Some patients have hypotonic uterus, or we call it as condition like uterine inertia. In this condition, uterine contractions are of low intensity and of short duration. They are very of low nature, or intensity of that contraction is very low. They cannot pull the baby, and these contractions are not sufficient for the vaginal delivery. Also, they are of short duration. They remain for short time. We have 30 to 60 seconds duration in first stage, and then 60 to 90 seconds in second stage. But these contractions are of short duration. They just remain for 10 to 15 seconds, and those contractions are not sufficient for the successful vaginal delivery. So uterine contractions of low intensity, short duration, those are called as uterine inertia or hypotonic uterus. This condition is specially seen in grand mal tivera patients, advanced age patients, low age patients, anemic patient, weak patient, patient who is already exhausted because of the excessive pain or any strain during pregnancy, especially in twin pregnancy where the uterus is quite stretched during the 9 months and during labor, the contractions are not sufficient. Maybe in some patients with hyperamniosis, excessive fluid, any abnormal large baby. So all these ladies may have, these patients may have uterine inertia or hypotonic uterus. Next type is hypertonic uterus, or it is called as colicky uterus. Hypertonic uterus means there is hyperactivity or hypertone or increased tone of the uterine muscle, but this pains, uterine muscular pains, are not in that manner that will cause successful vaginal delivery because there is no coordination between these contractions. In the physiology of labor, we had discussed about the secretion of oxytocin from maternal pituitary gland, and this oxytocin acts on the uterus, and there is formation of gap junction. Because of the formation of gap junctions, the contractions are transferred uniformly in the uterine cavity. There is formation of upper uterine segment that usually contracts. The uterine fundus is the actual part which contracts, but there should be coordination in between the contractions. It should not be like that some part of uterus is contracting and other one is relaxing. That will be of no use. Those contractions are of no use. So even in presence of normal or hypertonic uterus or increased intensity of contraction, if they are not uniformly spread on the uterus, there will no use for the vaginal delivery. So in hypertonic uterus, there is incoordination between the contractions, though the contractions are of increased intensity. Colicky uterus is the term where the uterine parts contracts separately. There is no coordination between the uterine contractions. Next type is hyperactive lower segment. That means we have discussed the formation of lower upper active segment and lower passive segment. Upper segment has to be contracted, relaxed, and other things should happen in upper segment, and lower segment has to just dilate. But in this condition, there is hyperactive lower segment. That segment or cervical segment becomes hyperactive. Contractions and other things are also seen in this segment. It is of no use. This segment just have to be dilated during the labor. So whenever there is hyperactivity of this lower segment, that will cause the insufficiency for the vaginal delivery. In that, there is a term which is called as cervical dystocia. Cervical dystocia means it is the term where cervix becomes thin but it does not dilate. Cervix is closed. Cervix has to be dilated during the labor. From 2 cm to 10 cm cervical dilatation takes place in normal delivery. But in this condition, in dystocia, there is thinning of cervix. Cervix becomes thin but there is no dilatation of cervix. So that is called as cervical dystocia. So these are the various types of prolonged labor, and especially these conditions are seen in patients with abnormal babies, large babies, twins, hyperamniosis, or a patient with advanced age, low age, anemic patient, or patient with grand multipara patients. So these are the various types and causes of prolonged labor. Now, diagnosis of this prolonged labor is very easy. This is clinical judgment. Whenever the hypotonic or uterine inertia is a condition, we can notice or we can note down the intensity and duration of the contraction. How many times that contraction remains? For first stage, duration of contraction is 30 to 60 seconds, and the contraction remains for just 10 to 15 seconds. Then the frequency, 1 to 4 contractions per 10 minutes in first stage, 4 to 5 contractions for next stage. So this duration and interval between the contraction, all these things we can notice, and because of that we can notice the insufficient contractions in uterine inertia. Contractions are very short and of low intensity, so we can diagnose the condition. Clinical features of this condition: patient have labor pain, patient have cervical discharge, show bloodstream discharge, passage of fluid, and other things are usually normal. and patient is usually settled, or because of the low contractions, she is always in the normal condition. Hypertonic uterus is the condition where there is increased labor pain. In that also clinical judgment is easy. Contractions are increased in duration as well as in frequency. They are frequently coming and usually there is no relaxation. There are continuous contractions. Because of this, clinical features of this condition are patient have excessive labor pain, unbearable pain. There is exhaustion, dehydration of patient, shock signs can be seen. Upper abdomen, there is continuous contraction can be seen. FHS are not so easy to herd. So these are the things which we can find in the hypertonic uterus. Next is cervical dystocia or hyperactive segment, lower segment. In that PSPV examination, if we do, other things are normal in this also, but PSPV examination, cervix is very tight and it is closed. There is no dilatation, absolutely there is no dilatation of cervix. Cervix does not start to open. Even in presence of normal contraction, lower segment or cervical dilatation is not there. So that is cervical dystocia. So these things we can diagnose by clinical examination. And depending on that, we have to give the treatment. So management, as always, it is obstetric condition. Prevention is always better because many things cannot be done on the labor table. So just to avoid the maternal as well as fetal complication, prevention for these patients is very important. So prevention is during ANC checkup. We can group the patient, patients with history of these types of labor, patient with previous history of any bad obstetric history, patient with anemia, patient with any high risk factor, patient with any abnormality during ANC or during pregnancy, increased blood pressure or PIH condition, twin pregnancy, hydramnios, abnormal presentation of baby like breech baby or transverse baby. Aged patient, age more than 30-35, or low age patients, multi-para patients. So these patients we usually grouped as a high risk patient, and in any condition cesarean is kept ready for those type of patients. In some patient where abnormal presentation like breech, transverse, occipital posterior and with high risk factor, we directly do the planned cesarean. In some patient where the age factor is normal, considered as normal, there is no BOH, bad obstetric history, presentation is also normal, we can give the trial for the vaginal delivery, or else it is advised for the cesarean. Now, active management for this. Active management for prolonged labor is again given depending on the type of prolonged labor. If patient is having hypotonic uterus, if she is having low intensity contractions or low contractions, insufficient contractions, then we, in this condition, we advise for the injection oxytocin. We do the proper PSPV examination, monitoring of patient, rule out CPD, FHS should be normal, rule out any high risk factor, mother related to mother as well as baby. If other things are normal, patient does not having any high risk factor, baby is also normal, FHS are normal, presentation is normal, at that condition we can give the trial for induction of labor. We induce labor by injection oxytocin, IV fluids are given, multiple fluids are given, injection epidocin for dilatation, and with proper fundal pressure episiotomy we can do delivery. So proper use of injection oxytocin is very important. If still it is not successful by giving oxytocin injection, induction of labor is not successful, vaginal delivery is not taking place, then patient is referred for cesarean. But in hypotonic condition, as patient is stable because there are no pains, so patient is quite normal, so we can give the trial for vaginal delivery considering other factors, and injection oxytocin works well, and by inducing labor pain, we can do artificial rupture of membrane, we can give injection oxytocin repeatedly also. By again careful monitoring of pulse, BP, temperature, FHS and other things, vaginal delivery usually takes place. Labor management is same, like first stage management, second stage management and third stage management, all things are similar to management of normal labor. Next is hypertonic uterus. In hypertonic uterus, the management or treatment is different from the normal hypotonic uterus. In hypotonic uterus, we have to induce the pains. We have to increase the intensity because hypotonic intensity or contractions are not sufficient. So we have to induce the pains. But in hypertonic uterus, as there are excessive labor pains, though they are not coordinated, but still they are excessive in nature, and those pains are causing trouble to mother. Because of the excessive pain, she may go in shock or maybe dehydration, acidosis, and other conditions. Because of the over these contractions, baby becomes also hypoxic, fetal hypoxia and fetal death. So chances of these types of complications are increased. So we have to reduce the complication, reduce the contractions. So for that, we can give analgesics, mild sedatives, and we can reduce the intensity and frequency of contraction. We can sedate the patient in early stage, or we can give analgesic in early stage, and we can settle down her condition. And during second stage, where actual contractions are required, we can plan accordingly. And by giving injection epidocin, that is the injection which is given only for dilatation. It is not for induction of contraction. We don't want to induce any type of contraction. Already there are excessive contractions. So we use sedatives, analgesics in early stage, and during second stage we give injection epidocin for dilatation, and vaginal delivery is tried. Considering the other factors, maternal as well as fetal factors should be normal. But in a hypertonic uterus, chances of vaginal delivery are less, because there are excessive contractions, and those contractions doesn't settle by the mild sedatives or analgesics. Trial can be given, and if patient settles with all this condition, vaginal delivery is expected, otherwise cesarean. Hyperactive lower segment or cervical dystocia, it is the condition where we can give the trial for injection epidocin, because in this condition contractions and other things are usually normal. So induction of labor is not required, but we have to do the dilatation of cervix. So we give injection epidocin for dilatation of cervix. In some cases, they give the incision on cervix and they artificially open the cervix. But those things can complicate the condition. And so if a cervical dilatation is not taking place by injection epidocin, then we refer the patient for cesarean. So these are the things which we do for prolonged labor. Next, abnormal labor is obstructed labor. This is the labor, or this is the abnormal labor, where there is obstruction of fetus, or fetus is difficult. This is a difficult labor where fetal presenting parts are obstructed in pelvis, and uterine contractions are normal, but fetus is obstructed in the pelvic cavity. That is called as obstructed labor. Causes are fault in passage, CPD, cephalopelvic disproportion is the major cause for obstructed labor. Any abnormal growth in the pelvic cavity, like uterine fibroid, uterine cyst, tumor, ovarian cyst, any abnormal growth in pelvic cavity that leads to this obstructed labor. Fault in passenger, abnormal baby, large baby, twins, hydramnios, congenitally deceased baby, malpresentation, abnormal presentation like bridge, occipital posterior face, bro, these things. Fault in power, there may be sometimes hypertonic uterus, hypotonic uterus, overuse of injections, sedatives, psychological factors. So all these things, they can cause the obstructed labor. Because of the obstruction of labor, there is usually contraction starts, labor pain starts, baby enters in the pelvic cavity, but because of the abnormal presentation, occipito-posterior presentation, like we had seen, whenever there is extension of head, it cannot passes through the pelvic cavity, so it is obstructed in the pelvis. If it is face presentation, bro presentation, the diameter of fetus from occiput to face is more than the oblique diameter of pelvis, so there is obstruction. In buttocks also, if at all there is passage of buttocks from the pelvis, sometimes shoulder gets arrested, or in some cases buttocks are only arrested in the pelvic cavity, or any abnormal presentation that may lead to arrest in the pelvic cavity. And at that point, baby is arrested in the pelvis and there are contractions, so the patient or mother have many complications, chances of uterine rupture, excessive pain, exhaustion, dehydration, acidosis, infections, all these things can happen. Baby is arrested. Because of the arrest of the baby in the pelvic cavity, there may be hypoxia, fetal death, meconium passage, and chances of fetal death are very much increased because of the obstruction of baby in the pelvis. So all these types of complications can take place. Clinical features are clinically diagnosed condition it is. On labor table only we can diagnose the obstruction of labor. Baby is not passing from the pelvic cavity, it is obstructed in the labor and increased contraction, uterus is continuously hard, FHS becomes irregular and excessive bleeding. These things can be seen and because of this we can diagnose the condition on the labor table only. And we have to take the decision for immediate cesarean. So elective cesarean is done, and by doing cesarean, sometimes if other things are normal, we can give the trial for ventuse or forceps. Assisted delivery can be tried with the application of forceps. We can easily deliver the baby by giving proper fundal pressure. So arrested baby can deliver with the forceps or ventuse application. Or if not possible, then cesarean is indicated. So these are the things. We had seen various types of abnormal labor, prolonged labor, obstructed labor, abnormal uterine action. So these things are considered as abnormal labor or labor disorders. So this completes your series of labor, normal labor, anatomy of normal labor, physiology of labor, mechanism of labor, management of labor, abnormal presentations of baby during labor, right from occipital posterior, bridge, vertex, transverse, all these presentations we had seen. Also we had seen the labor disorders, prolonged labor, abnormal uterine actions and obstructed labor. We had also discussed the complications of labor, PPH, retained placenta, inversion, embolism, all these things are seen. Also we had seen the puerperium, that is the normal post delivery period, and the diseases related with puerperium like puerperial pyrexia, inversion of uterus, embolism, thrombosis during this puerperial period. So these are the things which are considered in the labor pattern. So that completes the labor series.